When Desmond finished school days and joined the working world, his aim was to go somewhere where he'd meet a lot of girls, because Desmond carried tickets on himself, most people felt, and his mind was firmly centred on concerns below his belt. He felt life in the city would much better suit his needs than vegetating in the country with us hicks and hayseeds. That young man could see no merit in a life out in the sticks. For him, a sports car and a penthouse and a large array of chicks. Now, Des came back to see us when a year or two had gone, just to show us poor dumb locals how well he was getting on. I'd say he only came to visit so we all would get to see the blonde Sheila he brought with him and his shiny new MG. In the pub we eyed the blonde off, quite impressed by Des's luck. With her miniskirt hiked up her thigh, she sipped her fluffy duck. But she cast her eyes around as Desmond paid for high-priced grog. A rich squatter's son slid in there like a mongrel cattle dog. Poor Des was trapped up at the bar. He'd never had a chance. The squatter's son was fairly smooth. He whipped her up to dance. And while most of us were grinning, young Des looked fairly sick as that slimy rich boy did his best to white ant Des's chick. Now, it would appear the squatter's son was doing fairly well, but country pubs, they shut at 10, it saved Des by the bell. Not one to miss an opportunity, he pulled his girlfriend's chair, and as quickly as he could, he got the blonde piece out of there. Desmond started up the MG to show Blondie round the town. With embarrassment averted, he was starting to cool down. In fact, he'd near forgotten that young slimy squatter's son as he listened to the throaty purr and gave the car the gun. "I'll show you around the old place," we heard young Desmond say, and he sprayed the pub with gravel as the MG raced away. They went tearing over Crompton's Rise, the headlights lit the trees, then the sound of crunching metal floated on the nighttime breeze. It was always there on Saturday. It blocked the road in part, so we knew with perfect certainty they'd hit the Dunny cart. None of us saw the accident. The crash was all we heard, but even if they weren't deceased, they had to be interred. Well, we jumped in cars and got there with all possible haste to see Desmond and his girlfriend sitting waist deep in the waste. Now, a crash into a night guard is no place you'd want to be, but it's much worse if you are sitting in an open-topped MG. It was a scene that you'd imagine as a punishment from hell, the night soil oozing everywhere. I can't describe the smell. Then old Ben the copper cracked us up as he was prone to do when he said, "Desmond, it looks as if you're really in the poo." Well, the nightman saw the joke too, because he had no poo on him. He'd been up a client's driveway carrying another tin. Des and the girl, to put it mildly, were fairly on the nose, but the fire department fixed it up with their high-pressure hose. Well, the Sheila turned on Desmond and told him just where to go, but when she squelched towards the squatter's son, he didn't want to know, so she screamed abuse at everyone while Desmond hung his head, and I don't think I should repeat the words that young girl said. Des and the girl left separately, and we've seen Des no more, but we laugh about him all the time, and one thing is for sure, if you're looking for a yarn session to help some stories start, just make mention of the legend of Des and the Dunny Cart.